In today's video, we're going to be using the Kenhub Atlas of Human Anatomy to learn all about the large intestine. And then afterwards, we're going to be jumping on over to the Kenhub website, where we're going to put all that information to the test. Okay, so first we're going to open our Kenhub Atlas of Human Anatomy to the abdomen section, and we're going to go to page 267, and we're going to be focusing again on the large intestine. Now, right off the bat, I want to clarify the difference between the large intestine and the colon. See, everything you see here is the large intestine. So let's quickly go over that. So we have the cecum, which is this blind-ended pouch, which is the first section of the large intestine, and then hanging off of it is the infamous vermiform appendix. Vermiform means worm-like, and this does indeed look like a worm. So this is going to be the beginning of our large intestine. And from there, we then go to the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, and then the rectum and the anus. Everything I just mentioned is part of the large intestine. However, if you were paying close attention, you might have noticed that I sometimes said colon. You see, the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, and sigmoid colon, well, those are the colon. The cecum, appendix, and the rectum are not part of the colon. Those are separate structures, but together we loop it all together as the large intestine. So oftentimes you'll hear these being spoken of interchangeably, but that is technically inaccurate. So what I want to do is kind of go through the process of, you know, everything that's going in here and through here and how it all works, because the overall focus and I guess goal and job of the large intestine is to absorb water and electrolytes from the material that wasn't able to be digested in the small intestine. You see, like this empty space here, well, the small intestine are located in here. So that's going to be your duodenum, your jejunum, and your ileum. And we can even see this little pink part right here. This is the terminal part of the ileum. So this is the end of the small intestine. So what would be flowing through here is what we call chyme. Chyme is like this liquidy nutrient paste, and all the nutrients are being absorbed, except there's going to be certain material that are not going to be absorbed. And what will happen is that will then be dropped into the cecum, and we now call it feces. This is all going to be indigestible matter. This is stuff that your body has determined to be waste. Now, what it's going to do is go through this part here called the ileal papilla, also known as the ileocecal valve, but you can't really see it. See, we'd have to kind of like cut open this first part in the cecum here, but what you'd find is a valve that is the entry point from the chyme entering into the cecum. But what it does is it prevents backflow, so the material doesn't go back into the small intestine, right? You want this is a one-way road, right? As soon as you swallow something, it goes in the esophagus. It should be going down a very specific one-way directional path until it eventually exits out the anus. You don't want things going backwards, and the ileal papilla is what is going to prevent that from going back into the small intestine. Now, we then move into the ascending colon, but maybe actually first we could talk about these little dangly things that are coming off of the large intestine here. These are called the omental appendices. These are little pouches of fat made of peritoneum. And peritoneum is just the connective tissue that basically lines the abdominal cavity. But we're going to see there are all sorts of folds and ways the peritoneum can find itself manifesting inside of this abdominal cavity. But it's kind of an active mystery as to why the omental appendices take this shape, right? We know what they are. They're fat. We just don't know exactly why they take this exact shape. It's kind of an open, interesting mystery that we can just talk about when it comes to the omental appendices. But again, we have digestive material that's moved from the cecum that is then going up the ascending colon. Actually, I just realized I should probably also mention the appendix. The appendix it's not vestigial, or in the sense that it's not this leftover of evolution that is useless, that is on its way out. We have learned that this actually plays an interesting role with the immune system, as also with probiotics and just the microbiome. Really interesting little area, but if this thing does get inflamed, so normally it's about the width, maybe of this pencil, maybe a little thinner than this pencil that I'm using, but if it ever gets to be bigger than a pinky, then it can potentially rupture. And if it ruptures, you're obviously in a lot of trouble, which is why you want to get appendicitis treated very, very quickly. But just a quick little FYI. So again, we're going from the cecum. We then go up the ascending colon, and then we make this turn. Now, this turn isn't quite labeled here. We haven't put it in the image. This is what we call the hepatic flexure. So hepatic is in reference to the liver, and the liver would be right here, this massive organ. And so where we are turning and turning into the transverse colon, we call that the hepatic flexure. And now we're in the transverse colon, and the transverse colon transverses or traverses from the right side of the body, which this is what the right side, to the left side of the body. But what we're also going to see is this connective tissue up top, which we call the transverse mesocolon. Transverse mesocolon is just connective tissue that is helping to anchor the intestines to the body wall. In fact, we see that in other places too. If you look here, you can see what's called the mesentery. See, the mesentery is also made of peritoneum, the connective tissue, and that is going to anchor not only the large intestine to the body wall, but also the small intestine. And inside of here, you're also going to find blood vessels that are essential for helping to drain blood back and send it to the liver eventually. So again, the intestines are all about absorbing nutrients or absorbing water and salts, those types of things. We got to get them to the liver and back into the bloodstream. The mesentery is essential to that. But we can also see right here, which is called the mesoappendix. This is part of the connective tissue that kind of anchors towards that vermiform appendix and also provides blood vessels and things of that nature to the appendix itself. So we have that transverse mesocolon up top, but then what we also have is this little flap here. But in reality, this is not a little flap. This is called the greater omentum, and this is really an apron of peritoneum that drapes over the small intestine. Really interesting piece of tissue that we don't really have the time to go into all its fascinating functions. But one of my favorite functions of it is it can even migrate over, say if someone has appendicitis, and clinicians have found that it can help to like cinch around the appendix to try and prevent the spread of the infection. A really interesting piece of tissue that has been cut away for the sake of this image so we can see what we need to see. But this little thing right here, this is what we call the greater omentum. So we are going from the right side of the body over to the left, and then we're again making a turn. And this time, again, it's not labeled here, but we would call this the splenic flexure. And that's because the spleen would be right here. So we are turning into the descending colon. And this is, you know, this probably is intuitive to you. The reason why we call this the descending and this is the ascending is because the feces are going in this direction, right? It's going up, it's ascending, it's going transversely, and then it's descending. So that probably makes sense to you, but that is, again, the name of it. But you might also be wondering, well, how does it move? Right? Like how is this actually happening? Well, that's where we can talk about the tinea. So there's three different types of tinea. You can see what's called the free tinea, which is going to be right here. We'd also see it on the anterior side over here. We have the mesocolic tinea, which is going to be on that medial aspect, which again would also be on this side as well. And then we have over here what's called the omental tinea, and that's on that lateral aspect and also be here. Now it's a little bit different up top, so you actually have the tinea that are running underneath on the transverse colon, behind and on top of it. But the point here is these are actually smooth muscle bands. So what's happening is they contract and move and help propel the fecal matter up from the cecum to the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, just keeps on going around. In fact, though, it ends in the rectum. There are no tinea inside of the rectum. It's only going to be inside of the rest of the large intestine. So again, the tinea is just going to be smooth muscle. Another interesting artifact of its contraction, though, is it helps create these bulges. So you probably have noticed it kind of looks like ribs, but these little bulges here, these pouches, these are called the haustra. The haustra are just little sections of that are created by the contraction of the tinea. And what happens is it's really fascinating. These haustra themselves and the tinea, they will contract and propel the feces around every 25 to 30-ish minutes. So basically it's like, as soon as the digestive material enters here, about a half an hour later, it moves it to the next haustra. Next half an hour, next haustra, so on and so forth. That rate can obviously vary depending on just the motility of the individual colon, which is one reason why fiber and all that kind of stuff is really important. But the haustra themselves are created by the tinea. But then we also have what are called the semilunar folds. And the semilunar folds are kind of like these little divots, right? It's almost like if you think of it like the mountains and valleys, the semilunar folds are like these little creases in here that separate the different haustra. Okay, so then we're going from the descending colon to the sigmoid colon. Now, the sigmoid colon is often described as an S-shaped curve of the large intestine. So this is your sigmoid colon. And again, we can see connective tissue kind of anchoring it to the body wall, and we call that the sigmoid mesocolon. But at this point, this is where you're starting to be aware of the fact that you have feces, right? Because you're not really aware of this. This is all happening or should be happening without your real awareness. You might feel a few of these contractions, but it shouldn't be anything significant. If it does, or if you do feel that, that's cramping and that's not going to be great. But at this point, this is where you're starting to become aware of things. And as then it enters into the rectum. Now, the rectum is actually made of skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscle is voluntary, which is awesome. This is one of my favorite things. It's the fact that I can decide when to vacate the large intestine, right? But at the same time, I don't want to have to think about this. So this, it makes sense for the rest of it to be made of smooth muscle, which is involuntary, but the rectum itself is going to be made of skeletal muscle, which again is really, really cool in my book. And then the anus is going to be on the outside. Now, there's a lot more to the rectum. It's kind of interesting if you could actually see it here. We don't have the time in this video to go over it explicitly, but there is some really interesting anatomy, including different anal sphincters inside of the rectum. But with that said, that is pretty much all of the large intestine. So what we're going to do now is jump on over to the website, take a quiz, and see how we're processing all of this information. Okay, so I've already navigated to the Kenhub website and searched for the large intestine. We're going to scan through this study unit, which I always encourage you to check out our study units. It's very convenient. We pack in a ton of information, including videos, quizzes, articles, you name it. Everything we have on that structure, we have packed into the study unit, but we are going to jump down to the large intestine quiz. Now, I already took a quiz to kind of like prepare myself, kind of make sure everything's all lined up, but when you come here, it probably won't tell you congratulations that you successfully finished your first quiz. But we're going to go ahead and click the quiz here, and we are going to see that we have two different quiz modes to choose from. Now, this is a newer feature that we are very excited to discuss, because here we have a study session option, and then we also have an exam quiz option. And the exam quiz is exactly what it sounds like, right? This is going to test your knowledge with exam-style questions. The study session is also going to, I mean, it's going to test your knowledge, but it's going to do it with spaced repetition. And spaced repetition is basically, you know, you're asking a question again. And when you ask it again, and then again, and again, but not like right after each other, but you space it out, right? Spaced repetition, right? Studies have shown that that is very good at cementing the information into your brain. So we're really excited about this. Now I'm going to go ahead and reduce the duration down to 5 minutes. We're not going to need any more than that. And then let's go ahead and jump into this quiz. Okay, so the quiz has loaded. So what we see here is an image, and then we're going to see a green highlighted portion. And our goal is to identify the green highlighted portion. So we have this up here, and I'm going to have to go somewhat quickly through this. So if you need to pause this, zoom on, in on the video, you're more than welcome to. But we see this green highlighted portion up here. Is this the ileal papilla, the transverse mesocolon, the terminal part of the ileum, or the mesentery? I always feel like there needs to be like Jeopardy music, like do 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 do. Sorry, it's probably annoying. This is going to be the transverse mesocolon, right? This is the connective tissue kind of like anchoring the transverse colon down. Okay, so now we have this portion right here. Is this the transverse mesocolon? Which probably not, considering we already know what that is. Is this the ileal papilla, the terminal part of the ileum, or the mesentery? Again, just give you a second. This is going to be the mesentery. So the mesentery is, again, what also anchors the intestines down. All right, so we have this little portion here. Now, it's right next to the mesentery, so it's easy to get those confused. But is this the semilunar fold of the colon, the sigmoid mesocolon, the mesoappendix, or the greater omentum? For me, like, I just want to give you some strategy that I like to, you know, discuss with my students is, you know, sometimes you just want to look what's around it, right? To try to identify what you know for a fact. And then from there, that can sometimes just give you enough information to figure out what you're not sure of. And so, the reason I say that is because the answer is going to be the mesoappendix. And I say that because you can, if you recognize this as the vermiform appendix and something's attached to it, it might lead you to the correct answer. I was half expecting the appendix to be the next one. All right. Okay, so here we have this green line coming down here. Is this going to be the greater omentum, the sigmoid mesocolon, the mesoappendix, or the semilunar folds of the colon? Again, I don't really think I need to tell you this, but if you can do process of elimination, right? Like we just discussed we just discussed the meso appendix, and that's not it. So you can pretty much cancel that out. So I think that is kind of nice. So is it the greater omentum, the sigmoid mesocolon, or the semilunar fold of the colon? This is going to be the greater omentum, right? This is that tissue, that apron of peritoneum that kind of just drapes down over the small intestine, which are absent but would be right here. Okay. We're doing good. Okay. So now we have this little green thing right here. Now, in earlier when we discussed this, we didn't have these little windows into the large intestine. So we actually couldn't see this structure. So if this is looking a little different to you, that's because we couldn't see it in the other image. But is this the transverse mesocolon? But by the way, I gave you enough information to figure it out. Is it the transverse mesocolon, the mesentery, the ileal papilla, or the terminal part of the ileum? Take a moment. This right here is going to be the ileal papilla, or it also is known as the ileocecal valve. This is the valve that prevents backflow from the, you know, feces going from the large intestine back into the small intestine. Definitely would not be a good thing. All right, so now we have this little thing right here. Is this the transverse mesocolon, the mesentery, the ileal papilla, or the terminal part of the ileum? Now, if you've been paying attention, I'm pretty sure we've discussed three of these already, which through the process of elimination can tell you what this is. But let's see if you've been paying attention. This right here is going to be the terminal part of the ileum, which means this is the end of the small intestine. This is where it is going to be emptying into the large intestine. All right, so now we have these little lines. And again, we did not see these in the other image as explicitly as this, which is one reason I really love these quizzes, because it can build off of the images we've already had and just show you some, you know, them in greater detail. So are these the greater omentum, the meso appendix, the semilunar folds of the colon, or the sigmoid mesocolon? Oh, we gotta go fast. We're almost at 20 seconds. So this right here, these are gonna be the semilunar folds. Okay, so I wanna at least get one more question. All right, so we have this large structure down here. Is this going to be the rectum, the sigmoid colon, the mesocolic tenia, or the free tenia? This will be the last question. So it'll wait for us to finish, so take your time. Chances are you got this one right. This is one that a lot of people recognize right away. This is going to be the rectum. So I think we did really good on this quiz. What's cool is when you're done with the quizzes, it'll even tell you like when it recommends you take another quiz. We did 100%. Content discovery. We did really well. We had a 4% knowledge increase. Really, really awesome. So again, I really encourage every single one of you to check out our new quiz modes. You're going to enjoy it. The large intestine, for whatever reason, is genuinely one of my favorite structures to teach about in the human body. And it's been this way for years. Maybe it's just that I want to talk about poop. I don't know. But there's just something very fun and fascinating to me about the large intestine. And my hope is that, you know, that came across in today's video. And I also want to just speak to the power of this study method of combining the Kenhub Atlas of Human Anatomy with the website. Honestly, this is my preferred method of studying. And it's something like, obviously I'm biased, right? This is a Kenhub video, but like, I'm telling this to my students that I'm teaching in the classroom today, where it's like, look, if you want to come away from a study session, really understanding the material, feeling very confident as you are walking away, this is the way to do it, right? You read about it, you look at it, you kind of digest and absorb the information, then you jump on over and you read an article, right? You watch a video, you take the spaced repetition quizzes that we've worked really hard on behind the scenes, and we feel it is the best way to take a quiz. Like, if you were able to combine all of this, there's absolutely no reason that you cannot come away from a study session just feeling like, you know what, I got this. I'm gonna do great on my next quiz, on my next midterm, on my next exam. There's absolutely no reason. Again, I'm biased. Try and prove me wrong. But thanks for watching, everybody. Be sure to leave a comment below about other structures, other aspects of the human anatomy that you want us to discuss in future videos. There's a whole lot to discuss, and we're happy to do so. So be sure to drop a comment below. We'll leave links to the Kenhub Atlas in the description, as well as to the website. So be sure to check those out. But I'll see you in the next video.